Continue our discussion on metallization. So far we have discussed the selection of materials and what are the requirements which one has to consider, one has to take care while selecting a particular metal composition for contacts and interconnects of VLSI. And we have considered different metallization schemes like aluminium, gold, and then also we have considered polycrystalline silicon as a contact material. We have thought about the silicides and also some nitrides of metal. Refractory metals also we have considered, and out of all those we found that aluminium has got certain advantages, although it has some problem, but most of the points are favorable. Most of the properties of aluminium are favorable for VLSI metallization, and in some cases aluminium can be mixed with some other metals so that aluminium alloy may be used for resolving certain problems. Now in this class we'll discuss on the technology, that means how those films are obtained. So there are several schemes available for getting those metal films. One is known as physical vapor deposition, and for physical vapor deposition the techniques used a resistance heated evaporation, electron beam evaporation, inductively heated evaporation, sputtered deposition, CVD. So these are the various schemes which are used for depositing metal films. Out of all these schemes, only CVD has been discussed little bit in detail in chemical vapor deposition class. So here I will not repeat that discussion. I will concentrate mainly on this four scheme, what are resistance heated evaporation, electron beam evaporation, inductively heated evaporation, and the sputtered deposition. And a resistance electron beam and inductively heated evaporation belong to the same class, only the filament is different, but they belong to the same class of physical vapor deposition, and the equipment are almost the same except the evaporation mechanism. Okay, all the five schemes which are mentioned here require a vacuum chamber. You require a vacuum chamber, that means the physical vapor deposition are done in a chamber which is evacuated up to a certain vacuum level using different pumps. Okay, without, because in ambient you cannot, normal ambient pressure, you cannot deposit any of the metals because the ambient is having lot of gases. During evaporation, those gas and the metal film will react each other and they may form oxides or nitrides or some other composition. That is why the deposition is being done in a high vacuum, and that vacuum level is of the order of 10 to the power minus 6 millimeter of mercury in case of metal vapor deposition. But in case of sputtering, after evacuating, then again you have to inject some gases whose which is ionized to sputter some neutral argon or other gas, argon or nitrogen. Sometimes the argon are mainly used because these are heavy metals, so they are used for sputtering purpose. And then the during the deposition process, the pressure maintained is a low, it's of the order of milliliter to 10 to the minus 4 torr in that region, few milliliters basically. But in case of physical vapor deposition of using resistance heated electron beam or inductively heated evaporation, the base pressure is maintained at least 10 to the minus 6 millimeter of mercury. So now the question is how this vacuum is created. This particular vacuum, how can you evacuate a particular chamber up to that vacuum level? And that is done using certain vacuum systems, vacuum pumps, and those are mentioned now. The rotary pump is one, then is oil diffusion pump, then cryosorption pump. So rotary pump, oil diffusion pump, cryosorption pump, molecular ion pump, then sublimation pump. So these are the five pumps mainly used for creating the vacuum in the vacuum system. Diffusion pump system commonly have a cold trap to prevent the backstreaming of pump oil vapor into the chamber. Now, let us discuss little bit on various pumps. What are the basic principle how the vacuum is created? In case of a rotary pump, is a mechanical rotary pump. There, you know, there is a rotor and there is a stator. Rotor is rotating with the help of a motor with a certain speed, and oil is used, that is rotary pump oil is used in the vacuum. When rotor is rotated, so is due to this rotation, some air in the chamber is suction, and that is injected into the other ambient. So that is the basic principle. Suction of the air or gas, whatever it is, in the vacuum chamber by the rotor when it rotates, and it ejects into the ambient. So that is the basic thing of the rotary pump working principle. And the second one is oil diffusion pump. In this particular pump, we use a heavy oil, some high molecular silicon oil is used sometimes, the heavy oil, and that oil is vaporized first, it's evaporated, and the oil vapor is suddenly condensed. A baffle chamber is used, and that baffle chamber is cooled using cold water circulation surrounding, using some pipe circulation of cold waters, and again it can be cooled suddenly using some liquid nitrogen trap. The baffle chamber is encapsulated using some liquid nitrogen chamber, and when the diffusion pump oil, the diffusion oil that is first evaporated using by heating technique, that temperature is nearly 250-300 degrees centigrade, you heat and then oil will be evaporated. And if you suddenly condense, then what will happen? The oil droplet, it will form droplets, and droplet will fall into the oil chamber again, and when they are falling into the oil chamber, they will drag some of the air molecules from the chamber, and the baffle is connected with the chamber. So when the air molecules are dragged by the condensation, that is basically shower of oil molecules. You are vaporizing the heavy oil and suddenly condense, so it will form droplets, and droplets of those oil vapor, they will make a shower. And since it's a heavy oil, they will suddenly fall on the liquid chamber where it is again evaporated, where it will be again evaporated. So because of the sudden shower of the oils, so lot of air is getting suctioned or dragged from the vacuum, and that is backed by rotary pump so that you can evacuate gradually the chamber. That is the basic principle of oil diffusion pump. Now another one, third one, is cryosorption pump. In a cryosorption pump, here some cryogenic fluid is used, and that cryogenic fluid is nitrogen, liquid nitrogen. And in the liquid nitrogen, you know, it condenses nearly 80 degree or 70 degree Kelvin, 77 degree Kelvin, I believe. So there it there is the liquid nitrogen temperature. So if a particular chamber is kept at liquid nitrogen temperature, then there in ambient there are a lot of gases which liquefies, which gets liquefied at that liquid nitrogen temperature. For example, oxygen, carbon dioxide, whatever there, they will liquefy before the liquid nitrogen temperature. That means at liquid nitrogen temperature, many of the gases in the ambient will liquefy. Liquefy means that is not in gaseous form. That will condense, and that is absorbed by an absorber. That liquid, which is condensed, that is absorbed by an absorber, which is kept into that cryoabsorption pump chamber. Now, if the cryoabsorption pump chamber is always poured with liquid nitrogen, so the gases which can condense above that temperature, they will condense, so automatically some vacuum will be created. And after a certain interval of time, those absorbed material where the liquid has absorbed, so that is heated, and the rest of the gases are vented through a particular way, in particular path, venting path. That means the cryoabsorption pump, after a certain interval time, has to be heated, and then the adsorbed materials are again formed gas, and that is mixed in the environment. And there the valve is, that is the connection path of the vacuum system and the evacuation chamber is closed. Then you heat it and vent it, and it will mix with environment. So that means this is the cryoabsorption pump principle. And here you don't require any oil. Next one is molecular ion pump. Molecular ion pump does not require any coolant or any sort of cryogenic liquid. The basic principle of molecular ion pump is that it starts working up, not in the ambient, at a certain vacuum level. So basic principle here is you have to create some ions. That means you have to have certain electrodes, cathode and anode. You have to apply certain voltage. So whatever the gases is left after the cryoabsorption pump evacuation, those gas molecules may be ionized. Okay? And once it is ionized in the presence of a high field, then those ions may be attracted towards the cathode. And the cathode is certain material, they will absorb on the cathode and stick on that. Okay? So that means after creation of certain level of vacuum by cryoabsorption pump, then you switch on the molecular ion pump, and that molecular ion pump again ionizes the rest of the remaining gases, and which are absorbed at the cathode. They may form the cathode certain reaction, form certain solid there. So that means again certain level of vacuum you can create using molecular ion pump. So next comes the sublimation pump. The sublimation pump basic principle is sublimation, you know, and that is a particular solid material is evaporated from solid material to the gaseous material, and again from the gas it comes to the solid. Intermediate phase of liquid is not there. That is sublimation, isn't it? That means a particular material is used and it sublimates, and when heat condenses and again form the solid, so during that period some of the remaining gases will come out due to this condensation of that of the sublimated vapor, sublimated material. So one of the popular material is titanium. Titanium sublimation pump is popular, and the sublimation pump works at a high vacuum level. That means continually the base pressure is created of the order 10 to the power minus 6 to minus 7 or minus 8 range, sublimation pump doesn't work. That means the pumps, oil-free pumps, is cryogenic pump, molecular ion pump, and sublimation pump. All these three pumps are worked in sequence to create very high vacuum. And rotary pump and oil diffusion pump, another class of pumps where you require oil. Rotary pump require oil, and oil diffusion pump also require oil. and oil pumps has got certain problem of contamination. Although we are using some baffle chambers, the oil vapor may enter into the actual vacuum system, vacuum enclosure where evaporation is being done, and there is a chance of contaminating the film. But the oil free pumps means cryoabsorption molecular ion or sublimation pump, since they don't use any oil, so chances of getting high purity metal films is there in if you use oil free pumps. That's why in UHV system where we use high quality metal films or semiconducting films, UHV CVD also we mentioned sometimes. So ultra high vacuums are created for deposition of either film or deposition of some semiconducting material, semicrystal also. So there we prefer oil free pumps only to avoid contamination from the hydrocarbon oil, which are there in case of rotary or diffusion pump. There is another oil pump which is known as turbo molecular pump. So that is a very high speed oil pump basically. And turbo molecular pump is also oil pump, but their pumping speed is extremely high. Okay, so these are various pumps normally used in vacuum evaporation systems. But here, just now I mentioned rotary and diffusion pumps require oil, whereas others are oil free pump. Okay, these are vacuum systems. Now we'll discuss on evaporation or evaporation systems and evaporators. So evaporation of metals. Metal layers are deposited by evaporation in all early semiconductor technologies, the very old method. A simple evaporator, what is its working principle? Let us discuss on that. Wafers are loaded into high vacuum chamber that is commonly pumped with either a diffusion pump or a cryo pump, or if you need UHV, then you have to go for the ion pump or sublimation pump. Then the charge or the material to be deposited is loaded into a heated container called the crucible. That means a simple evaporator, one component of the evaporator is the pumping system. Second component is the crucible, where you keep the charge or material to be deposited. That is kept in a crucible. And another component is the heating arrangement. One is vacuum system, one is crucible, another is heating arrangement of the crucible. The crucible is heated by means of embedded heater and an external power supply. Charge or metal gives up vapor when it becomes hot. Metals are sometimes known as a charge. The charge or material to be deposited is loaded into a heated container, which is called a crucible, and crucible is heated by means of embedded heater. And the power supply are external. You can control the power supply or temperature of the crucible by external adjustment of the current and voltages. Charge and metal gives up vapor when it becomes hot, because the metal, when it will reach the melting point, so it will form the liquid, and that will make the vapors of metal. And now here the first thing is a vacuum. Why we need the vacuum? One, as I told you, with the ambient it may react and form other composition. And another purpose of creating vacuum is that when the vapor are formed and that vapor most travel inside the chamber in a straight line without collision, That means mean free path is will be very high. Mean free path, you know, is the average distance before collision takes place. So that means if you create high vacuum, then mean free path of the molecules will be high, and as a result of which, what will happen? You can the metal vapor or molecules of the metal vapor, they can follow a straight line path, which has got certain advantage to achieve uniform film thickness. Because if there are a lot of scattering and lot of collision in the vapor, then you cannot gauge the uniform thickness of the metal film on the entire wafer assembly system, on the entire wafer assembly system, and also the quality of the film will not be good. Okay, so now let us see some of the schematic diagram of a evaporator. This is a diagram of evaporator. Here you see, this is the one bell jar type of thing. This is a vacuum chamber, and here is the crucible, and charge or metal films are kept inside the crucible, and wafers are kept on the top of the crucible, and it is attached some wafer holder on the vacuum chamber surface here. These are the wafers, and this is the crucible, and this is the charge, and this is the evacuated chamber. There is a vent gas, so that sometimes you have to vent air into the chamber when evaporation is completed. You have to vent gas into the chamber. If you don't have the venting arrangements, then you cannot take the wafers, because you cannot remove the bell jar once it is evacuated. Until the pressure inside and outside are same, isn't it? And there are two paths. One is roughing pump, another is the backing pump. Backing pump is the diffusion pump. This is a cold trap. This is a baffle chamber, as I mentioned. Cold trap. This is the diffusion pump system, is known as a backing pump. This is a roughing pump. By roughing pump means we can use here a rotary pump. Using rotary pump, we can create vacuum of the order of 10 to the power minus 3, some cases 10 to the power minus 4 millimeter of mercury. But using the backing or diffusion pump, you can go up to 10 to the power minus 6, or 10 to the 6 minus 6 millimeter of mercury vacuum. Since the pressure inside the chamber is less than 1 milliliter, the vapor atoms travel in the chamber in a straight line without collision. Because if pressure is less, mean free path is more, vapor atoms travel in the chamber in a straight line until they strike a surface where they accumulate and form a film. From the charge here, the molecules of the metal move in a straight line, and they will deposit on the wafer. They accumulate their metal molecules and they will form a film. Okay. Evaporation system may contain up to 4 crucibles to allow deposition of multiple layers without breaking vacuum. Here one crucible is shown. Similarly, multiple crucible up to 4 in number, you can be accommodated inside the vacuum chamber, and you can use different external power supply. And sometimes with certain arrangement, the same power supply subsequently one by one can heat the different crucible. And in that case, it is possible to deposit multiple layers without breaking vacuum. Okay, so that is also possible here. Now, let us see a complete vacuum evaporator system, how it looks like. Here, this is the figure of the vacuum evaporation system here. This is the bell jar, and that is made of stainless steel, because you have to make the bell jar so that it can withstand high pressure. Inside the chamber you are evacuating, outside is atmospheric pressure. So automatically a lot of thrust there on the body of this chamber. So it has to withstand. So for that, the bell jars are normally made with stainless steel. And there you can see some of the lines are coming in here and there. Have you noticed? See, this is the line are coming here, here and here. This line, these are basically the coolant. There is a liquid chilled water. Any low temperature liquid, normally chilled water, is flown into these small pipes which is attached on the surface of the chamber. So the chamber is cooled. Okay. And these are the controls, and you can see the gauges through which we can estimate, we can know the vacuum inside the chamber. These are normal gauges, are Pirani gauge and Penning gauges are used. There is some sensor which can give the vacuum data inside the chamber, and some of the controls are also shown in the panel to control different valves. Here some of the external feed throughs are there, because you have to apply power inside the chamber to heat the field, so you need a feed through, so those are there. And in the bottom you can see some picture. These are the wafer carriers. Here these are the small wafers are fixed in hemispherical body. These are the wafer carriers. Wafers up to 24 in number are suspended in a frame above the crucible. In the last figure I have shown the crucible, and on the top you can suspend in a frame. The frame looks like this, hemispherical frames, and there you can fix wafers up to 24 in number, which are just through a fixture. It is suspended so that when metals are evaporated, uniform thickness of metal films are obtained on all the wafers. For alloy deposition, multiple crucibles can be operated simultaneously. For getting alloy deposition, multiple crucibles can be operated simultaneously so that the different metals are evaporated and they mix together and they deposited on the surface of wafer. I will discuss how there are different techniques of multiple metal evaporation, and their advantages also I will mention in the next slide. Mechanical shutters in front of crucible may help abrupt start and stop. Sometimes in front of the crucible, some mechanical shutters are used, which will help you to deposit some film with abrupt interface. Abrupt start and stop is possible using some mechanical interface. So this is the complete vacuum evaporator system. Okay. Now, one of the important problem in the evaporation of metal is step coverage. That particular point I have mentioned earlier also, in various consequences, in various topics, in particularly in epitaxy and other cases also I mentioned this step coverage problem. This is a very important aspect in metallization, because when you are metallizing the substrate, there lot of surface is not exactly planar, because a lot of contact windows are open which are of various depth, and depth of the contact windows are not same in all cases, because oxide thickness on the surface are not uniform over the entire wafer. Okay, so obviously the step of the windows depth are different in different contexts. So how to cover that? That is a very much critical problem, and if step coverage is not proper, you can face open circuit of certain connects or contacts and interconnects. So now how this step coverage problem is solved, we'll discuss now. Primary limitation of evaporation is the step coverage. Here step is the cross section of a contact etched through an insulating layer down to the substrate. That is the step. So this particular picture will show you how the step coverage is important point, why steps are not covered completely. Now we concentrate on the drawing, this diagram. This is crucible. Here is a source. This is a charge or the metal is here. The crucible is heated, and from the source, molecules are evaporated. Metal vapors are evaporated, and these are the wafers. On top of the source, the wafers are kept, and these are the contact windows. Here is the window, and the blue color is the silicon dioxide, and red color is silicon. Silicon, silicon dioxide, and these are the windows. Now, here is the source, and wafers are fixed surrounding the source over a large area. Okay. Now, just now I mentioned in a vacuum, the molecules move in a straight line path. If the molecule of the metal moves in a straight line path, so it moves in this straight line. Here, from here, it moves in this straight line. So, in this condition, you can see some portion of the wafer which is not covered. And you can see here this portion. From anywhere, from the source, metal atoms or molecules cannot reach in the surface. Similarly, in this particular wafer, this particular corner, this particular place, metal atoms or molecules cannot reach because of the shadow action. Here, since the metals are moving in a straight line path, so below that particular ray, here no metal molecules can come. But in this, which is just vertical to this, just nearest to the source, just on top of that, here all the portion will be covered by the metal film, because that is not the situation of all the wafers, because wafers are fixed there over a hemisphere. So the wafers which are just on the top of the source, their step coverage problem is less. But the wafers which are away, where the molecules of the vapor are incident obliquely, here molecules of the vapor are incident obliquely for oblique incidence, because of the shadowing action, this portion and this portion metal will not be deposited. But here it will be thicker deposition. Here also deposition will be there. On the top of the silicon dioxide, there is no problem of deposition. Similarly, here deposition will be there, here will be there, but except this small portion. So this is the problem known as step coverage problem. Okay. Assuming that the incident atoms are immobile, if incident atoms are mobile, then these steps may be covered. What do you mean by mobility? That once the molecule comes here, it is deposited there. If the molecule themselves after deposition can move along the surface, then after depositing molecules here, they may reach here, they may cover here. After deposition, the molecule may move up to this portion, they may cover. So then the problem may be solved little bit. But if there is no mobility of the ions, that means assuming that the incidents are immobile on the surface of the wafer, the topology will cast well-defined shadows. These are the shadows, well-defined shadows, and film will frequently be discontinuous on side of the contact. Here, discontinuity will be there. Side of the contact discontinuous here. So this side of the wall is completely filled with metal, and this side of the wall is not filled with metal. That is mentioned here. As deposition proceeds, the growing film on top of the insulator moves the edge of the shadow upward. Okay? So this is the step coverage problem. Now, how to solve that problem? One solution is also hidden here in that paragraph. I told you that if the metal atoms are not mobile, then the problem is severe. If the metal atoms are made mobile, if there is some mobility of the metal atom, then they can spread in the shadow portion. So how you can make the molecule, metal molecules mobile? Just by heating, substrate heating. In the substrate, backside of the substrate, if you put a strip heater, and the substrate during deposition is temperature is of the order of 100 or 150 degrees centigrade in that range, then just after deposition the molecule will move. It will have certain mobility. It will diffuse along the surface, and the problem will be solved little bit. There are another solution available, and that solution is known as the planetary rotation system in vacuum evaporator. How it looks like, let us explain that one. To rotate the wafer in the evaporated beam, the hemispherical cages used to hold the wafers in the evaporator are designed so as to roll the wafer around the top of the evaporator. Now, if the wafers are not fixed, if the wafers are moving, then what will happen, you see? Let us see in the other page here. You see, now here this portion is shadow. Now, if I rotate the whole system, so this portion is covered. Now, when this wafer is coming in this position, so this other region will be covered. That means by rotation of the total system, the shadow will not be fixed in a particular region. The wafer which faces shadow here, that will not face the shadow in the same portion here. So that means by the rotation of the substrate during deposition, that can be removed. So that is normally done in the next slide. That is mentioned in the next slide. So here, these are the hemispherical cages. So one cage, second cage and third cage, these are three wafer holders. They are rotated in this direction. You see, in this direction rotated. But each, the wafer carrier, they moves along its own axis. The wafer carriers are moving, rotating along its own axis, and the whole system comprising the three wafer carriers are moving in this direction, either clockwise or anticlockwise. Okay? And the wafers are heated using some radiant lamp heating. Inside the chamber, some lamps, heaters are used, and they are heated by radiation. So that means if you heat the wafers by radiation, surface mobility is improved. You are applying surface mobility. At the same time, using two-axis rotation of this particular wafer carrier, wafers, so then the position of the wafers is changing every moment. So that means with respect to the source, the contact window position is changing if the wafers are rotating. And in this way, you can remove the step coverage problem. Step coverage problem can be solved. So, to summarize what I discussed, modern deposition systems use planetary wafer holders. These are known as planetary wafer holders. Three substrate holders are mounted on a circular rail. This is one, and that is the third one. They are mounted on a circular rail in a way that is similar to planetary motion. There is a circular motion about the center axis normal, and each holder moves around in space about his own axis. This leads to improved thickness uniformity of the deposit over the step. Improved thickness uniformity you can achieve by this two-axis planetary motion. Just why it is known as planetary, just if you consider Earth. Earth is moving around its own axis. And again, the Earth as a whole is moving in an elliptical path surrounding the sun. So that is known as a planetary motion. Here also, each wafer holder is rotating along its own axis. And the whole system comprising the three substrate holder are again rotating in certain direction, just like Earth rotates around the sun. Isn't it? That's why it's known as planetary motion or planetary rotation. And that helps a lot to improve the step coverage. Okay? Now, the second method to improve step coverage is the substrate heating, just I mentioned beginning. Atoms that reach the wafer can diffuse across the surface before they chemically bond and become part of the growing film. Okay? Many evaporators use infrared lamps or low intensity refractory metal coils behind the planetaries to heat the substrate. That is the substrate heating arrangements are there in all modern evaporators, either by radiation heating, radiant heating, or using some coils, refractory metal coils behind the planetaries. They are used to heat the substrate. Now here in this diagram, you can see that if you don't use planetary rotation, so thickness of the film is there, so you have deposited the film here, but in this wall, because of the shadowing effect, no metal films have been deposited. If you go on increasing the thickness, it looks like this. Then in this portion, there is no metal film. So discontinuity is there between this metal and this metal, no continuous. That means low adatom mobility and non-rotated. If you don't use planetary rotation, at the same time, if you don't heat the substrate during deposition, then the metal film deposition looks like this type of structure. On the other hand, this side, the and window covered with the metal films is shown, and that deposition is obtained using both planetary rotation system, movement of the wafers when it is heated, and at the same time, the substrate heating arrangement has also been used. So, using both substrate heating and planetary rotation, the film deposition in the group or in the contact window looks like this, which is shown here. And in other cases, if you don't use those improvements, it looks like this. Surface diffusivity is given by dS equal to d naught e to the power minus Ea by kT. Ea is the activation energy, k is the Boltzmann constant, T is the temperature in absolute scale. Okay, that is the surface diffusivity if you heat the substrate during deposition. Okay, now we'll discuss on the different the heating system. One is resistance heated evaporation. It looks like this. A resistance heated evaporation system use either crucible of this boat size or the spiral wire. Refractory metals which has got very high temperature, whose melting point is very high, that means its softening temperature is very high, that is used for making some spiral, heated spiral, and this is known as the filament. And the source rod is inserted into this spiral, heated spiral, and when you feed power to this filament, the filament will be red hot, its temperature will increase, and the metal or source rod which is inserted into the spiral, that will melt and it will evaporate. That is the resistance heated evaporation. Basically, this is a resistance coil, and you are applying power to this resistance coil, and there the metal will be soft and it will be melted and it will be evaporated. But here some of the problems are the short filament line. Why? What happens if the metal rod, if you put just like this, so this heating coil is also a metal. If you use a tungsten coil, for example, and if you want to this say this, for example, this is a aluminium. So if you aluminium flex, if you use here, so that will short the coil. So wherever the aluminium touches the coil, they will make short circuiting their particular portion. So their current distribution over the coil is not uniform because of low resistance some portion because of shorting, and high resistance some other portion because of non-short. So if they, because of that current distribution different means, heating will be not uniform because generation of heat is for I square R, isn't it? So where current is more, heating is more, that will be melted more and evaporation more, and the sum portion heat is less. If the non-uniform distribution of current is there surrounding the coil, so it may break because some portion will be heated much compared to the other portion. So because of that non-uniform distribution of heat, the filament breaks, and if breaks means discontinuity, so current will be zero immediately, so it cannot heat. It cannot melt the material, cannot heat the material to be evaporated. That is the problem of this spiral coil. But here, a dimpled boat may be used, whereas a dimpled structure, where you can keep the structure, and this and this are fixed, clamped. This side and this side are clamped together. And if you put the charge here, and you heat it, and you can evaporate it, evaporate the material. So compared to the spiral heated crucible, if you use the dimpled boat crucible, so that has got advantage, it may have higher life compared to this one. And here you can put some more charge, more metal compared to this. Okay, but one of the major problem of this resistance heated evaporation system is that the film will be contaminated by the resistance coil, because you are using heating coil here, so that is in touch with that metal film, so it will be contaminated. That is one of the major problem. Either is use this type of heated spiral or you use dimple boat, in both cases it will be contaminated. And some other problem is the short life of this filament. And also when you are choosing the filament, you have to take care that the metal film, when it is evaporated, it must weight the filament. If it cannot weight, then what will happen? If it cannot weight, means there is a very thin layer of air gap. If it is a thin layer of air gap is there, heat will not be transmitted into the metal. So proper transmission of heat from the filament onto the source will not be there, and heating will not be perfect. That is the problem. So the main problems are, the advantages are simple, inexpensive, no ionizing radiation, small charge, and short filament life. Short filament light and contamination from the heating element are the disadvantage. Small charge is also disadvantage, but simple, inexpensive, and no ionizing radiation are the advantages in this sort of resistance heated evaporation technique. So I will stop here now. Next class, I will discuss on other two techniques. These are inductively heated techniques and electron beam evaporation techniques. This is a vacuum coating unit. In our theoretical class, we have already discussed how the thin films of metal, in particular aluminium, is deposited on silicon wafer using thermal evaporation technique. And this particular instrument is used for evaporation of various kinds of metal by resistive heating on and we will deposit the film on silicon wafer. And step by step, now we will show you how the wafer is kept on the wafer holder, how the aluminium film, the aluminium foil is loaded in the heater itself, and how the vacuum is created with the help of the rotary pump or diffusion pump, and sometimes we use liquid nitrogen also to cool the chamber of the diffusion chamber. He is lifting the vacuum chamber, which is a stainless steel belger. Now he is loading the silicon wafer on the wafer holder. The wafer holder in proper position. Now he is loading the aluminium foil on the resistive heating element, which is a tungsten filament. You can see these are the high purity aluminium foils which are being kept on the tungsten filament. And filament, this is the tungsten filament. Now he is loading the aluminium foil on the tungsten basket, which is a filament, and two sides of the tungsten basket are connected at the electrodes through which high current will be passed in vacuum, and the aluminium will be melted and it will be evaporated. Now he Now he has switched on the rotary pump, and the vacuum inside the chamber can be seen on this vacuum meter, which is it is taking some time to show the vacuum level inside the chamber. You see, from atmospheric pressure, the vacuum has been created. Now it is 450 millimeter of mercury, 380 millimeter of mercury. Gradually, the space inside the bell jar is being evacuated. Now it is 200 millimeter of mercury. The deposition is over. Now he is unloading the wafer from the wafer holder. He is taking out the wafer. Now you can see the wafer. Aluminium has been deposited.